Bryan Adams.
Wait, hang on. Where's Lorraine?
I'm so sorry.
No, it's not. It's no problem.
You only got me.
They said you're going to do Lorraine. I was like, well, Lorraine in the hotel.
I know. The mind boggles. Hello. But I'm sorry, Bryan. You're right. Stuck with
Hello,
me
Hello, Lorraine.
Morning.
How are you, love?
She is watching, okay. I promise. She's very, very excited about this because
nice.
We're both big fans. Here it is. Ultimate.
Wow.
The greatest hits album. Amazingly, right, you've sold over 60 million of these things, but your record company told you before you were going to release this that maybe it might be your last physical CD.
Yeah, the time has come where CDs are on that sort of preface
yeah.
where it may not actually exist in a couple of years. So I thought, well, yeah, if they want to do it, let's do it. That's why I went for a bright orange.
It's very bold. But of course, I mean, very difficult for you because you've released over 75 singles, I think,
have
in
I?
Your career. And you had to get it down to about 20. So you're basically having to choose between...
Yeah, it was tough.
Like your children, your songs.
Yeah, I kind of chose these songs because they're all songs that I actually play live.
Yeah.
There's a lot of songs that I've released that I don't play. There's only so many you can put in a night, really. I sort of put this together as sort of a package of these are for sure going to be in the show. So if you come to the show, these are songs you're going to see.
I'm so excited about that. So that's the ultimate tour, and that's like the greatest hits tour, which will be in the UK sort of next May.
It'll start next May, yeah. Then I'm taking a break to do this other project, which is the musical I've written, co-written.
Yes, well, I'm
Pretty Woman.
I'm going to ask you about that, actually. Okay. Because one of the songs on this album, Please Stay, you actually initially wrote. So there's two new songs on the album, but this song is one you initially wrote for the Pretty Woman musical.
Yeah. There's a scene in the film, I don't know if you remember, where she leaves and she has a bit of a tantrum with him. And then he comes back and he says, you know, stay. And that whole dialogue. So that would be a good moment for a song. But as it turned out, for the musical, there's other songs that are more important. And so this one, I mean, it may end up in there, who knew? But I don't, at this particular moment, in the way the musical is playing out, this one won't be on
there.
Well,
you've got to put it on the album, though, so that's
No, so I thought, they're not going to use it, I'll use it, you know.
How different is it writing songs for a musical compared to writing a song for your own album?
It's really fun. It's much like writing for film, where you have a sort of idea what you need to write for. You have a little bit of a storyline. You know, who knew? And so I really enjoy the whole thing, the process. I mean, I did a similar thing back in the 2000s for an animated show called Spirit, Stallion of the Cimarron, which is about a horse, where all the songs tell the story of that particular moment.
Yeah.
So with Pretty Woman, they didn't want the songs from the film. They want new songs that tell each scene and exactly what's happening in each scene.
And this is a musical that's going to go to Broadway
yes.
and then potentially, hopefully, the West End.
Oh, yes, I hope so.
Because it was such a big movie over here, so I'm sure it will.
I mean, I have no idea what's going to happen. So, I mean, we're opening in March in Chicago for a little test run. And then we break everything down and we ship it all back to New York.
Incredible.
Yeah.
Incredible. That's
exciting.
So great. Mm. Now, obviously, when you put all of your songs together like this, it just makes you realize how many Bryan Adams hits there's been over so many decades. Do you have a favorite? Or actually, let me force you to choose a favorite. I think mine is probably Please Forgive Me.
Oh, wow.
What's yours?
Well, I have the great opportunity to go every night and look down at my set list and go, oh, that one's coming next. Recently, I've been enjoying singing a song which was never a hit here called Cuts Like a Knife.
Yeah.
And there's something about that song. Like a lot of these songs, it seems like the longer that they stay out there in the lexicon of music, the more they sort of become ingrained in people's psyche. And you know, in many cases, I don't even have to sing them. You know, I could just turn the mic around and let everybody else do it. A song like Summer 69, for example, which wasn't a hit in the UK.
Crazy.
It never got on the chart. And
that's so weird.
But it didn't in a lot of places. It's not just the UK. I mean, back in about 93, a member of my record company calling and saying, Summer 69 just went to number one in Holland. And this is, you know, what, nearly 10 years after it was released.
Man.
So the song has had a life way beyond what the, sort of charting would have done. Sort of reminds me of the 70s when there would be rock bands that you'd like, let's take Led Zeppelin, for example, where they would have had singles, but their big songs were never really singles, and you just knew them because you were a fan.
But the one song that obviously did have chart success unlike any other to this day was Everything I Do It For You, which maintains the
record. Thank you for reminding me.
I mean, I'm sure you haven't heard of it. I'm sure you've never been asked this question either. But I am going to modernise this question, though, because do you know, last year everyone was thinking maybe it could finally lose its chart record because Drake, with One Dance, got 15 weeks at number one, but it still didn't match you. You still maintain that record.
Someone will one day.
One day?
Yeah, they will. It'll happen.
Would you be relieved when that happened?
I don't know. I mean, it's not something I sort of think about, really, you know. It's just the charts. Who knows?
Be honest, though. When you come to sing that song in your concert...
I just turn the mic around.
I was going to say, like, is there any feeling of dread? Is it like, no, not again?
No. I don't have that about my songs. You know, their songs are very personal to me. Yeah. So it's, you know, I really love singing them. And I think the songs that are, you know, that popular are what bring people to the shows as well. So, I mean, you have to play them and it's fun.
And obviously the difference with you, you wrote every one of your songs.
Yep.
So there is a very personal place there.
Yeah.
Now I have to
I can tell you exactly where I was on each one of those songs.
Really?
Yeah.
So where were you when you wrote Everything I Do?
I was in Willesden.
How glamorous.
So glamorous Willesden, in a studio, in the back of a studio, and we had the bit of the music from the film, and we were just monkeying around with trying to make something happen, and it just happened. And literally the song wrote itself.
Any idea that it was going to become one of the most iconic songs of all time?
No, I didn't have any idea. Amazing. If I did, I'd be doing it all the time.
Yeah, exactly. Now, you gave an amazing performance recently at the Invictus Games, which is obviously an event which really in the UK receives a huge amount of coverage, particularly because of how much it's become a passion project for Prince Harry. It's such an amazing thing for the wounded soldiers. Tell me about that experience, and did Prince Harry call you to personally get you involved, or did you know about the event beforehand?
Well, it's the second time I've played at the Invictus Games. I played it here in London as well, and if you know me, you know that I've been very supportive of the wounded soldiers. I did a book on it, a photography book on it a few years ago.
Yes.
So I feel strong about it, and so when I was asked to do it again, I was like, yeah, no problem, and it was a wonderful night. I don't know if you saw it or not, but it was pretty exciting.
You have a big connection with our royal family. In your other hat, as a photographer.
I'm not sure about big connection, but I mean,
I had to mention because your picture of the Queen from 2002.
Do you have that photo?
Yeah, it's one of my favorite ever of her, because you just managed to capture in this really natural way.
Yeah, it was a big gig. I'd been asked to join an agency called Camera Press.
Yeah.
And they're quite affiliated with the royal family. And one day I got a call and said, would you like to go down and do a photograph of, you know, for the Queen's Jubilee? And I was like, oh, yeah, whereabouts? They said, well, it's at her house. I said, oh, okay, great, yeah. which house? Buckingham Palace.
And also, on a totally different note, you photographed very recently the queens of daytime television, the loose women, with their clothes sort of off for their campaign about body issues.
I mean, from one side of one hat to the other, yes.
Exactly. Yeah. What was that like doing that? And were you surprised about how much it got people in the UK talking about body issues and this whole issue of being photoshopped? Like, that photograph was everywhere.
And the good thing, the reason I did it was because they didn't want to do any retouching and they wanted it to be natural. And so that suited my, you know, way of working. And so there it is. It's just all the girls all together mucking in and having fun. And it was really quite fun. It was a great afternoon.
Well, they are a hoot.
Yeah, they are. And I knew it was going to be a laugh. And so it's just a matter of seeing if we could get everyone to work together, and it did.
So you're obviously photographer, musician, you've got your live tour going. How do you manage to balance everything with being a dad, which I imagine is the most important job for you?
Yeah, I mean, it's good, and I spent the day with my girls today. It was really fun. Being a dad is everything, and you just have to point the direction of which way it's going to go and make sure you influence them. And I want them to be creative, and I want them to be, yeah. I want them to have a full, happy life. But at the same time, you know, learn about all culture and not just be isolated.
Ultimate, it's out now.
Thanks.
The tour takes place next year.
Yeah.
And believe me, when you listen to an album like this, you remember how many memories of your own life
That's
are
kind.
So intertwined you. With your song. So I'm so glad that you That's, decided to
yeah,
do it.
Give my love to Lorraine. Tell
I
her
will, I will. Life. Next time Thank she'll
you.
Be here.
Thank you. No, Thank no, you're right. fine. Don't worry.
I was okay.
Yeah, you're all right.